Hello, it's Keith here, and this is lesson 31 of the platform-specific series of my 6502 assembly programming tutorials. We're going to be looking at hardware sprites this week, and we're going to start on the Atari 5200 and 800. Now, compared to what sprites are defined as on other systems, these systems are a little bit surprising in that they're incredibly basic, really. And I think the reason for this comes back to the old days of the sort of Pong consoles that didn't really need much graphically, and I suspect looking at the way the sprites work, it's kind of been transferred across. So you can see we've got two sprites on screen here. We've got this kind of crosshair effect here, and we've got a wider version here. So we're using two sprites here. The system can have up to five sprites on screen, which is pretty poor, and they're only 8 pixels wide. However, they're the full height of the screen, which again is completely crazy, but that's the way they work. We'll understand a bit why they're the full height of the screen when we start to look at how they work. But anyway, we're showing two of them here, and we're going to go over the technicalities of how they work. So I'll just close down these two tiny, tiny windows here, and we'll start to discuss them. Okay, so I said there was five sprites. Well, we kind of have an option. The hardware itself has four player sprites and four missile sprites, for one for each of those players. But the missile sprites are just 2 pixels wide. Again, kind of sounding a little bit like a Pong paddle and a Pong ball or something. But we can compile all of those four missiles together to make one extra 8 pixel wide sprite. And that's what we're doing. And the example I just showed you was using one of the player sprites and the missile sprites all combined together to be the fifth player sprite. So that's what we're going to be doing. Now, when it comes to the sprites, we've got a wide variety of registers here that are involved in controlling the sprites. But basically speaking, players 0 to 3 or 1 to 4, depending how you number them, are essentially the same, just with slight differences to the numbers of the ports. And it's only the missile sprite that's a little bit tricky and we need to configure in a slightly different way because, as I say, it's actually combining four sprites together. So let's have a look at the code and we'll see what actually generated the image we just saw today. Okay, so the first thing we're going to be doing is we're going to be setting up the sprites themselves. Now, the way they work is basically as the screen is being drawn, the data that's being shown on the screen is constantly being changed every line of the screen. That's why the sprites are only 8 pixels wide, but the entire height of the screen. And the way it works is we have an area of our system memory, which is being used as the vertical height of the sprite, and the DMA is automatically transferring that memory into the visible sprite. Now, what we need to do is we need to define a memory address that is going to be used by that DMA. We're enabling the DMA just here. And we are then specifying the address that we're going to use as the base for the sprites. Now, I'm using base address 1800 here, but depending on the resolution of the screen, the actual address will change accordingly. And then depending on our resolution and the sprite we want to change, we'll need to copy our actual bitmap data for the crosshair in this case to the correct memory location. Now, all of this is a right pain, obviously. So I've got a very simple summary here, or relatively simple anyway, for the four player sprites, the missile sprite combined, and then the addresses that we're going to use for everything. So basically the entire height of the screen we're going to be using resolution 1, so the entire height of the screen is from 1C00 onwards for player 0, 1D00 onwards for player 1, 2, 3, etc. And then for the missiles, 1B00 here. And then we define the width of the sprite, because we can stretch the width of the sprite using D008, 9A, B and C for the missiles. And then we can define the colours. Now, with the missiles, we have two options for the colours. We can either set a common colour for all four parts of the sprite, which is what I've done in this example, or we can define the colour for the 2 pixel wide strips of the sprite, if that's what you want to do. I've got that switched off, though. Now, the X position we define for the four sprites, and then for the missile, because we're combining four missiles into one sprite, we actually have to set them all separately. Now, the addresses shown here are for the Atari 800. They're slightly different on the 5200. If you remember, the GTIA is at memory address D000, which is what we're showing here. But on the 5200, it's at C000. Now, this won't be affected in the code because I use a definition of GTIA here, which I define depending on what system I'm compiling for. So that's why we'll see those offsets there, just to correct that problem. Now, the memory address used by the DMA is actually the same in all cases. So that's not going to cause us a problem. So for the first sprite, player 0, we're using 1C00, and that's constant on all systems. Okay. So that's the theory of how we're using our memory. So at this point, we've defined... So at this point, we've turned on our sprites, and we have defined the base address for those sprites. Now, we just need to select that we're having the four players and enabling the missile as well with this port here. And then we are defining how we're going to use the colors. Now we're defining the missile to be the same color for all cases. We have a priority setting, and I've set the sprites to be in front of the background, which is what I think we're going to want in most cases. Now you can see here that when this sprite has gone over the background, it goes over the top, which I think is going to be what everyone's going to want. Now if I were to change this option here and compile again, you can see now this has actually changed colour, and the reason for this is we're now using the four player colours for the parts of the sprite, but that's not what we're going to do in this case. So we're just going to leave that, so we're using one constant colour for the missile sprite here. Okay, so these are just our sort of basic constants to set up the sprites to appear on the screen and to set the base memory address. We're now going to set up the player 0 sprite. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to define the width of the sprite. Now, you can see here I've set it to the maximum width. And that's made it very wide indeed. But we can alter this if we change it to 0.1 instead. Now it's much narrower, and if we change it to 0.0, it would be narrower again. So that's how we define the width of the player 0 sprite. We set the position of the player sprite in the x-axis with this option here. So if I change this to 60, it would move further to the right. Very straightforward. We define a color here. Now this is using the standard color options of the Atari. So we've got a brightness and a color here. So if I change this to a 3 and compile again, we've now changed to a kind of pink color from the yellow that it was before. And this nibble here is the brightness. So that's at offset 112 here for color for player 0. Of course, it's at different addresses for player 1. We're not going to use player 1 in this example. Now we actually want to define the sprite in our memory. Now the memory we're writing to is the memory address 1800 onwards that we defined here. There's very few addresses you can viably use for sprites, so I think you're probably going to want to leave that as your default. But the address we actually want to write to is 1C00 plus the Y position. You see, because the DMA is constantly drawing that sprite from start to end of the screen, depending on what we write into that memory area is actually going to define the position of the sprite. So if I change this to a 40 like this and run now, you can now see the sprite is much higher up, because of course it was at 80 before. Now if I just copy this whole section here, need to change this to a 2, and then if I change this to an 80, so we're now copying the sprite data into this memory area twice, you can see the sprite now appears twice in the vertical column. But these of course will move at the same time. If I change the X position, they'll both move at the same time. So really what I've made is a very tall sprite that just happens to have the crosshair in it twice. And of course if I wanted to move the sprite down, I'd need to clear the old sprite and draw the new one. So very weird the way it works, but you know, there's certainly potential for it. I can imagine if I was going to try and use these hardware sprites, I could imagine using it for a parallax effect where you had some trees in the foreground moving over your background area. Something like that would be a very easy way to use it and to take advantage of the fact we can have full height sprites here of the screen without any extra work. So anyway, that's what we do to define our sprite data, and that's really all it takes. We just write to the memory address the data of our sprite, which I've imported from a file. It's just a 1-bit per pixel file, obviously black and white. Now we're going to do the same for the missile. Now the missile is a little bit different. Because it's made up of four separate 2-pixel wide sprites, we've had to set the width for all of them separately here. So you can see there's 2 bits for the width here, 2 bits here, 2 bits here, 2 bits here, 4 sprites. So that's what we have to do there. And we're writing that width to memory address 0C offset in the GTIA. And you can see that just here. Now, we're going to set the position of the sprite by loading A here, and we have to write that to a lot of different memory addresses, you see. You see, we need to set it to 4, 5, 6, and 7 to set the four parts of the missile, because if we do this wrong, our sprite is going to come out all weird. So what we're doing here is we are setting the base address, and then we're subtracting 4 each time. Now, if I change this to 8, I'll just show you what happens. Now you can see our missile has, now you can see our crosshair has become all kind of separated here because our scale doesn't match our sprite. Maybe if we change these to 1, 1, that'll fix it. It looks like that has indeed fixed it. So we've got to make sure that we position the four parts of our sprite depending on what we're actually doing here. So we've got to build those missile parts into one part. We then define the common colour, because remember we've got that colour set to a common one, and we define that with GTIA plus hexadecimal 19. So we're setting the colour there. If we change this to 48 instead. Now you can see it's a dark red there, so that's how we can change the colour of our sprite in one go. And then again we're using the memory address here, 1B00 plus the Y position. So that's very straightforward, just copying the data into the DMA. And that's really all there is to it. So it's a bit of a confusing concept and a bit of a disappointing one from the point of view of, you know, the sprite capabilities of the Atari and nothing like the Nintendo NES, for example. But, you know, if you want to play with these, it's certainly very usable. Nothing wrong with it. You've got all these addresses here. There's a bit of a summary here. And as I say, if you want a quick look up, this is a relatively decent one for checking the addresses that you want to be working with. The example here uses resolution 1. You can halve the vertical resolution if you want and use these addresses instead, but to be honest, I don't think there's going to be any benefit to you to doing that, but it's up to you. Anyway, there you go. That's the example we're going to be looking at today. I hope you found this interesting. Thanks for watching and goodbye. If you enjoyed today's lesson, please check out my website. We've got tutorials, source code and development tools for 6502, 68000 and Z80 systems, and a lot more systems coming in the future. We're going to be covering the 8086 and the ARM and a few other things as well going forward. And if you've liked this lesson, if you've got questions, comments or suggestions on how it could be made better, please consider signing up to my forum. It's free, of course, and you can come along here and you can make suggestions, you can ask questions. And if you've got assembly projects you're working on, please let us know what they are. Maybe show off a few screenshots, tell us what things you've found interesting or what tricks you've come up with, because we'd love to know about it. Anyway, thanks for watching today and goodbye.